Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Nitin. I agree with him about 90% of his talk. I agree with, but I have my objection is only towards the lowering of LDL less than 25. So, how far to lower the LDL? I would be debating on lowering to less than 70. Yes, of course, Dr. Nitin had shown data. But lowering less than 25, a firm no, because there's no hard data to support this lowering to less than 25. See, whenever we do an intervention on a risk factor, what we are trying to look at is having a benefit which far outweighs the risk of the intervention. So do we have enough benefit data? We have data from two trials, one is Fourier and Odyssey. Do we have strong enough data to say that bringing down LDL to less than 25 to 15, is it strong enough? Is the data strong enough? In fact, the number of patients who achieved this sort of levels were not many. And you know, when we are trying to look at very small numbers and trying to infer that the intervention and bringing it down to those levels are going to be helpful, that is, I think, too much. This question was not there in the statin era, as Dr. Nitin said. Statins never brought it so frequently less than 25, but with PCSK9 plus statin, we have now levels going to even 15. In the Odyssey trial, about 9% of the patients went to levels less than 15, and the investigators were not very sure what would happen. They were afraid, so they stopped the treatment when the LDL went to 15. So our physiology tells us that LDL receptors are universally, ubiquitously distributed, as you can see, endocrine tissues, lung, the gastrointestinal tract, the male tissues, everywhere the LDL receptors are there, and we know the sex hormones, all those things, the cell membrane integrity, all are dependent on LDL. So now the concerns for lowering of LDL to less than 30 started with the Jupiter trial, where there was an increased in the risk of physician reported type 2 diabetes, physician reported hematuria, an increased risk of musculoskeletal, hepatobiliary and psychiatric disorders. So bringing down to less than 30 even by a statin is not totally safe. So then what about the PCSK9 inhibitors? There's an interesting article in Circulation last year which looked at the neurocognitive effects, and as you can see, the trials that were included were all short-term trials which range from 24 weeks to about 104 weeks, that is less than 2 years. And you know, the number of people included in the trials were also very less, except these two which had you know, about 300 and 500 patients followed up for about 78 weeks. Very short duration of follow-up and a very small number of patients, but what they found was the neurocognitive impairment was seen about 2 times in the people who had their LDL brought down by the PCSK9 inhibitors. So what's the connection between the circulating cholesterol and brain? There is a constant flux of oxysterols across the blood-brain barrier. Though they say the brain synthesizes its own cholesterol, it is dependent on the blood cholesterol. In fact, it is a paradoxical observation that is made out in the epidemiological studies. When middle-aged people, when they have dyslipidemia, high LDL cholesterol, their tendency to have Alzheimer's is more. But when they become elderly, they become more dependent on LDL, and if you bring down the LDL cholesterol to very low levels in elderly people, they tend to become the neurocognitive impairment starts developing. Again, there is a publication of the alirocumab trials, 14 trials, the randomized meta-analysis. What they found was the rates of cataracts were higher in patients who had their LDL cholesterol brought down to less than 25 versus more than 25. Again, what's the nexus between the LDL cholesterol in blood and lens? The lens, though it synthesizes its own cholesterol, the statin trials have shown that, or the animal studies with statins have shown that the lens cholesterol biosynthesis is affected by statins, and that increases the risk of cataracts. Even there's a study called Beaver's epidemiological study where the cataract incidence was more with aggressive statin therapy. what's the limitation of the analysis that I just showed? In the study limitations itself, they were saying that the sample size was very low and the alirocumab was used for a very short duration of treatment, and the total number of reported events was very low. So this means that whatever we are trying to infer from the meta-analysis is not that strong enough to, you know, say that the benefit is far outweighs the harm. And in fact, in the limitations itself, the authors themselves have written that the long-term effects of very low LDL cholesterol are unknown. A month ago in JAMA, there is an interesting editorial, I think all of us should read this, written by Antonio Gotto, who says that the current PCSK9 inhibitor trials, they're all short duration, and since uncommon side effects with the PCSK9 inhibitors would take some time, like he quotes the example of diabetes. Diabetes with statin was detected 23 years after its the first approval of lovastatin. So bringing down the LDL cholesterol to levels like 22 and 45 may require longer periods, and the periods that were included in Fourier and Odyssey, which is the basis for, you know, bringing down the LDL to less than 25, is not strong enough. So FDA mandates that the PCSK9 inhibitors, when they are used, you need to look at a gamut of, you know, side effects across the entire body. As we know, LDL receptors are universally distributed in the body. So to conclude, we have strong enough evidence to say that LDL has to be brought down less than 70, but as of now, as of date, there is no strong data to, you know, give a benefit to bringing down LDL to less than 25. Important safety concerns like cataract, you know, the neurocognitive impairments come when the statins drop to, you know, unphysiological levels like 25. And we have issues like the allergic reactions, injection site issues. And, you know, the most important thing is, without showing that there is no great benefit, are we justified in subjecting our patients to such high-cost medications? And of course, we may have to change our stance, provided we have studies with longer follow-up and larger sample size. And then till that time, I think we should try to get the LDL to the sweet spot between 70 and 25 and not bring it down less than 25. Thank you.